remarkable study. More than a year in the making, exploring the important role that civil legal aid plays in disaster preparedness and response, and recommends comprehensive ways to incorporate such legal aid in disaster planning. I want to thank Senator Cornyn of Texas for sponsoring this briefing. I also want to recognize and applaud the invaluable pro bono support for the task force provided by the Latham and Watkins Law Firm. It supported all of the subcommittees of the task force, and through the leadership of our co-chair, Jonathan Lippman, who you'll hear from in a few minutes, and his wonderful colleague, Rob Malinick, and a team of lawyers that they led so ably, supporting the workings of our task force and the ultimate preparation of this wide-ranging report. In addition, they hosted a field hearing last December in Houston and our launch meeting here in Washington last year. I also need to recognize that our tireless efforts and invaluable contributions, LSC's vice presidents for grant management, Lynn Jennings, chief of staff, Rebecca Burdick Cohen, program counsel, Mark Castello, John Eidelman, and executive coordinators, Laura Poole and Laura Moose, in shepherding this project to completion. I should have asked the Latham group to stand up to be acknowledged. Would you please do that? And then I'm going to ask you. We will be privileged this afternoon also to hear remarks from a distinguished member of the task force, the ABA's newly installed president, Judy Perry Martinez. Our LSC board member and also a task force co-chair, Father Pius Tietgen, will also speak in a few minutes. The third co-chair, LSC Vice Chair and Harvard's 300th Anniversary University Professor, Martha Minow, will be providing recorded remarks. Is that working? Okay, good. Michael Byrne, specialist executive at Deloitte, former senior executive with the Federal Emergency Management Agency, will share his insights into the significance of disaster preparedness. Our program also featured a panel discussion on the importance of relationships in disaster preparedness and response, moderated by LSC's longest-serving president, Jim Sandy. Another task force member, Central Kitchen founder, Jose Andres, well, he was planning to be here, but as you probably know, he's in the Bahamas, responding to the wake of Hurricane Jordan. And low-income families and individuals are typically the hardest hit by disasters like Dorian. And after their struggle for life and limb, they frequently have pressing legal needs, such as replacing identification papers, applying for benefits, dealing with insurance claims, preventing unlawful evictions and foreclosures, combating contractor scams, just to name a few of them. Our task force, which included more than 60 leaders from business, legal, emergency management communities, LSC grantees, other stakeholders, recognizes that legal aid providers are key to addressing the legal issues that arise following a disaster. The recommendations offered in this report highlight concrete steps to build a systematic, coordinated, sustainable approach to helping low-income families and individuals, communities prepare, respond, and recover from a disaster. You'll hear more about these far-reaching recommendations shortly, but taken together, they reflect an understanding of the importance of relationship building and partnerships in disaster planning, making sure that legal services providers have a seat at the disaster planning table, that law schools, businesses, private attorneys, disaster-focused volunteer organizations all also take part. The task force calls for greater preparedness everywhere, including courts and legal aid organizations who can't provide services if they're not themselves operational. And to make sure that this report has an impact, LSC will form a multidisciplinary working group to assist in implementing its recommendations. If you know anything about our board, we don't write reports to have them sit on the shelf, and this is no exception. LSC will also continue to educate the emergency management community about the importance of integrating legal service providers into their work. LSC has, as you know, expertise in working with a network of national and local partners to help legal aid programs serve low-income clients facing these and other challenges in the wake of a disaster, and through our coordinated national infrastructure. LSC grantees provide access to resources and information essential for communities to respond to disasters and emergencies. And with the LSC Disaster Task Force, LSC expands this vital outreach and response, and we hope provides a blueprint for making civil legal services an essential component of disaster planning. Our country has had to manage 288 major natural disasters just since 2014. As our board has met regularly with LSC grantees across the country during the last few years, we repeatedly hear about the significant long-term consequences for communities affected by such natural disasters. That is what motivated the creation of this special task force. And we're so grateful to each and every one of you on the task force for devoting so much of your time, providing us with your expertise and your insights. And you have brought us to this day and to the creation of this comprehensive report. Thank you for being there for your country, and thank you all very much for being here today. It's now my privilege to introduce the newly installed president of the American Bar Association, Judy Perry Martinez. She took the helm just 5 weeks ago, having held so many numerous leadership positions at the ABA during the past 30 years. Her previous positions included serving as the ABA's lead representative to the United Nations, chair of the Presidential Commission on the Future of Legal Services, chair of the Standing Committee on the Federal Judiciary. She's long been committed to public service, working with other members of the Louisiana Bar to establish the New Orleans Pro Bono Project and serving as its first chair. She currently serves as Distinguished Access to Justice Pro Bono Fellow for Southeast Louisiana Legal Services and on the board of the Innocence Project New Orleans, and she's an officer of the World Justice Project. She's of counsel at the law firm of Simon, Peregrin, Smith, and Redfern, previously was with the firm from 1982 to 2003 as a partner, where she was a member of its governing committee and a prominent commercial litigator. She went on to serve as general counsel for litigation for the Northrop Grumman Corporation, managing litigation for the western half of the country before becoming the company's vice president, chief compliance officer. In 2015, she became a fellow at the Advanced Leadership Initiative at Harvard University, where she spent a year in residence before returning to law practice in New Orleans. With a BA from the University of New Orleans, a JD from Tulane, it's my privilege to introduce the ABA's very distinguished president, Judy Perry.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for allowing me a few minutes of your time to talk to you about an issue that is near and dear to my heart, certainly. I know firsthand and all too well the disruptive and life-altering impact that natural disasters can have on our families and our individual lives, often destroying much about what we care about. My hometown of New Orleans was ravaged by Katrina. My state, of course, has been ravaged numerous times, most recently and significantly in the August 2016 floods around Baton Rouge. And I've watched the countless hurricanes and floods and tornadoes and fires that have devastated so much of our country for so many years, but it seems particularly so in these last several. And all of you in this room know that lawyers play a critical role in the road to restoration for those who are struggling to recover from these tragic situations, assisting them with needs ranging from the immediate to the long term. Legal assistance in these times of crisis is essential and nothing less. Attorneys provide information and they listen to survivors when survivors need to be listened to the most, when they need to be heard. Attorneys and staff, they work at the disaster recovery centers, assisting with applications, providing counsel, engaging in representation of landlord-tenant issues, disability benefits, unemployment benefits, and other matters. And attorneys use floodproof and other means to help homeowners establish ownership necessary to obtain FEMA and SBA and state recovery funds. And they help with FEMA appeals, and sometimes it takes years, and they render other help, as you all know so well, for so many years after the disaster strikes. As president of the ABA, of the American Bar Association, I assure you that our profession's role in this important work is at the forefront of the leadership of the association and our membership. Through our active, dedicated disaster legal services program, the ABA, Young Lawyers Division, working with FEMA, has for decades provided immediate temporary legal assistance to disaster survivors at no charge. Since 2017, our disaster legal services program has responded to 41 disaster declarations. Since only 2017, currently our efforts are focused on planning and preparedness in a significant way. And Dorian, Hurricane Dorian, just gave us a good check on the readiness of our state and regional teams along the Atlantic coast. That relationship building and that coordination is exactly what this LSC report talks about, how important it is to have it in a continuous process of building and strengthening so that when something happens, we are all on the ready. The ABA Standing Committee on Disaster Response and Preparedness and Standing Committee on Pro Bono, and also the SCLAID Committee, chaired by Andrew Van Singel, who's here with us, Ted Howard, as well as David Vievenu, who's not here. They continue to provide training for pro bono for lawyers and legal service providers. And in 2019 alone, they provided on or participated in substantive trainings in multiple states and have more training planned, training that the LSC report also calls critical and significant to this effort. And we encourage all states and territories to adopt the Katrina rule, which allows attorneys to take pro bono cases and disasters without being admitted in the affected state. And currently around half of the states in this country have a Katrina rule, which means that pro bono attorneys can even, in some of those states, deliver legal services remotely without even leaving their offices through ABA Free Legal Answers and many other means. And in 2017, we provided free CLE for legal service providers on business interruption planning, because we know from Texas and Houston and Louisiana and all so many places that when disaster strikes, it doesn't choose who it strikes. It strikes our frontline providers, and it is our obligation of the bar to get them up and running as fast as we can, because they are the most efficient and effective means of delivering legal services. We know that, we have the experience and the data on that, and we need to make sure that we are helping them get back on their feet in their offices and elsewhere in order that they can best serve. All of that is what this remarkable report talks about. So the bottom line is that we, the lawyers, need to continue to do this work, each and every one of us. We, the American Bar Association, we need to continue our disaster legal work in response and in preparedness. As we continue to strengthen our relationship with the Legal Services Corporation on this and on so many other aspects of its vital work. So thank you for not only this report, but for your tireless efforts on this issue and so many more. I'm encouraged by the presence of so many world leaders in this room, some from my hometown, the state of Louisiana. The ADA looks forward to continuing to identify opportunities of collaboration in our work to help heal and restore the lives and communities impacted by natural disasters. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Father Pius Petrick. I'm a member of the Board of Directors. This year being my ninth anniversary of my confirmation, I'm delighted to still continue to serve on the Board of Directors of the Legal Services Corporation. It's wonderful. Sometimes it's complicated. There we go. I'm just going to talk for a few minutes about our task force and the work we've done. I was surprised when John asked me to be on a co-chair of the Disaster Relief Task Forces. I didn't know anything about them. I knew they were bad, and they were to be avoided, but I wasn't sure what I could bring to the conversation. But I knew LSC well enough, and knew our board well enough to know, thankfully, that I would not be doing this myself, and for the benefit of all of you as well. Because we had a long history at LSC, at least with this board, before we came up with this task force. It began really, I think, shortly after we were on the board with our original task forces, with the task forces on pro bono and our financial oversight. Both of them did something that we had really never seen at LSC before, and that was opening up a task force to invite not just LSC folks, not just legal aid folks, but experts from throughout the U.S. with regards to financial aid, with regard to financial oversight, and with regards to pro bono. And LSC's report, especially the pro bono task force, was a report not simply to itself, but to the legal community, in ways in which we all could work together to create a better environment for pro bono in legal services and throughout provision of legal services in the United States. And that, I think, continued. You know, our thoughts with regards to this, with disaster relief, began early on. Shortly, a few years after we became on the board, Hurricane Sandy, of course, hit in 2012. And for the first time, I think, there were funds given to LSC to dole out as grants with regards to disaster recovery after Sandy, which we were pleased to do for a number of years. But it was shortly after Sandy, if you remember, in January of 2013, when we were at our board meeting in Louisiana. It was a wonderful board meeting. Let me just say, if you recall, it was also between Mardi Gras and the Super Bowl, so not the best time to be there. But I think being there with the remnants of Hurricane Katrina still affecting Louisiana, with us dealing with the impact of Hurricane Sandy on our grantees, I think that was really the moment in which we really began to think about, as a board, disaster recovery and our role in it. That was added to by a very generous grant that we received in around 2013. From a very large donor with regards to, or a large funder with regards to disaster recovery in the Midwest. That relationship with that funder has continued, and we've done an enormous amount of work since then with our grantees in the Midwest to increase knowledge and preparedness with regards to disasters. And we hope to expand that with the help of this task force to the rest of the world, to the rest of our grantees. But this particular task force, I think, really took hold in 2016 at our meeting in Cambridge. We were generously hosted by the Dean of Harvard Law. We had an in with the Dean at the time. Very nice one. She was on our board. Still is. But we had, at that meeting, we had a report, two different ones, from grantees with regards to the effects of disasters on legal services. And then I think a very important panel with the Chief Justices of the Florida and Texas Supreme Courts with regards to disaster recovery in judicial systems in those two states, looking at the recent hurricanes that had been in both of those states. And I think that, more than anything else, was probably the impetus for the announcement of our Disaster Recovery Task Force a little over a year ago. And since then, we kicked off a year ago, May of last year, with a meeting here in D.C., which John alluded to. We were pleased enough. I'm sorry Chef Andre can't be here today. It was wonderful to have him at that meeting. He's a great voice, a great passionate voice, not just about food, but about feeding people. And I think he gave that kickoff meeting, I think, a great spirit And we begin to organize the four sections you see in the disaster recovery report that we have, with the four committees that we broke into. And I have to credit Latham and Watkins and the folks there who did just the lion's share of the administrative, logistical, and just document production work that allowed those committees to flourish and take off and to produce the reports that you have there. They have been with us this entire way and frankly deserve far more credit than anything I've ever done. But that continued with meetings both in Miami and just even Miami this year and last year in San Antonio. One of the things I'm grateful for is when we did this task force, both at the kickoff and in the subsequent meetings and especially in the committees, this again wasn't just legal services folks. This was folks in federal disaster recovery, state disaster recovery, local disaster recovery, our grantees, people in academia who would work with disaster recovery. We brought as wide a pool of expertise as we could together to help us figure out what the real issues were and how we can best go about them. And I am delighted to see so many faces that I saw either in San Antonio or Miami, or even in our kickoff here in DC a little over a year ago, here again today, because they've been such an invaluable help to us in the production of this. And these committees have been meeting over the last year, mostly by phone. I was sat in on quite a number of them, at least listened in on a number of them, and I'm always amazed at how active they were, how engaged our committee members were with regards to this production. I'm then grateful finally to LSC and for Latham in producing this final report. So this gives you, I think, a little bit of the background. This report that you see in front of you is really almost a decade in the making with regards to the Board of Legal Services, and especially the very fervent and dedicated work of our committee members, and as well as Latham and Watkins in support of us over the last year. And they really deserve an incredible round of applause for the work and time and effort they put into it. And as you can see, I think, a report that really reflects that thoughtfulness, that carefulness, and that wide diversity of voices and expertise that come up with this conclusion. And you will see, I think, as we come today, as I invite Jim and his panel to come forward, and you'll see some of the quality of expertise that we've had over the last year, and you'll be able to hear a little bit from today. So thank you for your time, thank you for your attention, and for all those of you who have put in so much work to this task force, thank you for your dedication to this and for your service.
Good afternoon. I'm Jim Sandman, President of the Legal Services Corporation. Our panel this afternoon is about the importance of relationships in repairing, responding to, and recovering from disasters. The point is this: the full range of response needs to include legal aid, and legal aid needs to be integrated with all of the other service providers dealing with a disaster. We need an integrated team pulling together. Our panel is very well experienced in these issues. I'd like to start by introducing them. To my far left is Paul Furr, who has served as the Chief Executive Officer of Lone Star Legal Aid in Texas, based in Houston, the nation's fourth largest LSC-funded legal aid program. He's been the CEO since 2001. He previously served as Deputy Director and CEO for East Texas Legal Services. To my left is Ellen Joseph, who is pro bono counsel at Vinson & Elkins, based in Houston. She coordinates and manages all of the firm's pro bono activities. She previously worked as a staff attorney at Houston College of Law Legal Clinic. To my immediate right is Will Polk. Will is the Deputy General Counsel in the North Carolina Department of Public Safety and currently serves as in-house counsel for the Division of Emergency Management in North Carolina. He previously served as Deputy General Counsel in the Office of the Governor of North Carolina. And to my far right is George Housen, who has led Legal Aid of North Carolina since 2002. He is its President and Executive Director. At the beginning of his legal career, after graduating from law school, he was a Peace Corps volunteer in Haiti and the Dominican Republic. He worked as a staff attorney at the Lawyers Committee for Better Housing earlier in his career as well. I'd like to start by setting the stage to talk in big picture terms about what happens after a major disaster, and start with Will and with Paul. Will, in North Carolina, you've experienced a series of significant hurricanes going back to 2016, as I recall. And Paul, Hurricane Harvey was an unbelievable experience in Houston. I'd like to ask each of you, starting with Will, to describe what the impact of the series of hurricanes in North Carolina has been, and Walt, what happened as a result of Harvey.
Thank you, and thank you very much for having me here today. I'm speaking on myself, not speaking on behalf of my agency, but with that being said, as Jim mentioned, since 2016, North Carolina has had significant impacts from three major hurricanes. Hurricanes Matthew in 2016, Hurricane Florence last year, and most recently Hurricane Dorian. And two of those three storms were storms of record for our state, those being Matthew and Florence. And in between all that, we also had several tornadoes in the central part of our state. We also had flooding from various storm systems and the remnants of other storm systems. And so we've had our fair share of natural disasters in our state. As a result of those of Florence and Matthew, the state did receive an individual assistance major disaster declaration under the Safford Act from the President of the United States. And also from the Tropical Storm Michael, we received a public assistance disaster declaration from FEMA, as well as another public assistance declaration request for Dorian. And we also received another Safford declaration for the tornado. So we've had our fair share of our FEMA partners showing up to in our state. As mentioned before, our state was first impacted by Hurricane Matthew in 2016. Just to give you a sense geographically where the storm hit, it was along the corridors of the US 64, which is sort of northeast North Carolina, the I-40 corridor, which basically stretches from Wilmington, North Carolina, up through the central part of our state, the triangle, heading west to California, of course, and then the I-95 corridor, which basically runs from north to south through our state. So Matthew impacted that entire area from Virginia to South Carolina to pretty much the central part of our state. Much like what happened during our last storm record, which prior to that was Hurricane Floyd in 1999, which we just celebrated the 20th anniversary of, many areas that were flooded in our state were areas beyond a typical river basin flooding. These were storms that just came in and parked and just stayed for days. Either Matthew as it danced along the coast, or Florence where it just came up through central North Carolina where it made landfall off of Wilmington and just stayed in this flooded areas that flooded outside of normal typical riverine flooding. There were areas where people did not think would flood. And some of the impacts from that storm with Matthew were over 100,000 structures that were damaged and up to an estimated $1.5 billion in financial losses and was responsible for 25 deaths. Florence was one that, again, as I mentioned, came up through Wilmington and hit the same areas almost 2 years after Matthew did. So the same people that got impacted by Hurricane Florence, Matthew, were also hit again by Hurricane Florence. So they were just getting their lives back together and they get hit by a catastrophic event again. That storm was an estimated $17 billion in damage to our state. So as you can see, between those two storms, these were very catastrophic events to the individuals in our states. And over 50 people died as a result of that storm, either directly from the storm or things that happened indirectly whenever a storm comes through. So the $17 billion was more than Matthew and Floyd combined as far as Hurricane Florence. So Michael, thankfully, did not have the same impact as far as the people, but it did have an impact on our infrastructure. And Dorian, we just are, as you can probably see from the news, people have been impacted in the coastal communities, and we're still doing damage assessments to that storm. So we have made a request for public assistance disaster request from the president, but we haven't heard whether or not it was granted yet or not. But that's just some of the flavor of some of the things that we dealt with from major events in our state.
Well, the task force report emphasizes that the legal problems that arise from a disaster unfold over a long period of time. There are immediate issues that might be more obvious to people, but other issues that can linger for years. What you describe with a series of storms has to have a compounding effect. Can you say something about the cumulative impact of these storms over time and how it affects disaster response and recovery?
Right, right. So the cumulative effect of these storms is this section, this area in North Carolina we have our major metro centers in Charlotte and the Triangle as far as Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill, Greensboro Triad. The southeastern part of North Carolina, you have Wilmington, which is a metro area, but then the other areas are pretty rural, and they're agri-based communities. Some of the environmental impacts you see from these storms are from the Hall Lagoons that sometimes will breach, particularly in 1999 with Floyd. We monitor that very closely at emergency management with each major storm that comes through. So those areas are already relatively economic depressed, they're very dependent on agribusiness, so whenever you have these types of storms, it does have a major impact on their daily lives and their livelihoods. And of course, housing is a major area, major issue in that area where there's a real dearth of affordable housing that these individuals who are impacted by the storms can reach out to. And then housing stock. I mean, there's not a great wealth or inventory of housing so that when these storms hit, they have a place where they can go to, say, to rent a home or public housing or anything like that. So when these storms hit, housing is a huge impact to those individuals. And because we had two storms, major storms, on top of one another, these individuals are still in the process of trying to rebuild their lives through that. And we've had some innovative programs through FEMA this past storm. We had the STEP program that was implemented to help residents after Florence and Matthew. We had some temporary housing that was provided from FEMA, but a lot of it was just vouchers that were given to individuals frankly, they stayed in hotels and motels for extended months. And so that was a real challenge, and it's an ongoing challenge for our agency and our partner agencies like Legal Aid to be able to respond to after these storms. So we were holding our breaths when Dorian was coming through the state because we've just been slammed, quite frankly.
Paul, can you describe the impact of Harvey in Houston? Lone Star Legal Aid was itself a victim of that hurricane. Can you describe how your service area was affected and also what the impact was on your organization's operations?
Sure. Yeah, that's good. Harvey caused 103 deaths. That's one metric that we are starting with. There were 41 federally declared disaster counties affecting about 1.8 million eligible clients. Damaged over 200,000 homes, 700,000 automobiles, dumped over 34 trillion gallons of water into the affected areas. Nederland, a little city outside of Beaumont, received 64.5 inches of rain in a 24-hour period, setting a new national record. There were nearly a million FEMA applications made after Harvey. Harvey was, once you got to the flood part of it, was what they call a 1,000-year flood. And when you're in the planning business, you hear all the time about 100-year plans. Well, this was a 1,000-year plan. 40 of our staff were moved out of their homes. Not all of them destroyed, but they didn't have a home to go back to. And then we had a second disaster. Which was the fire in our main office in downtown Houston. There was an electrical utility vault underneath the street next to our building. A sump pump quit working, and when you go through disasters, I'm told you get more familiar with this. I will never forget it. Blew the transformer up, which blew the transformer in our building up, caught the building on fire, and we were out of that office. We're not back in yet. We hope to be back in February. This would be a good point for me to thank Ellen Joseph, who's next to here, and all of the pro bono councils at all the law firms in Houston who really perform yeoman service helping get us back up on our feet. Many of our staff in Houston didn't have a place to go. they have an office to go to, so they were quite willing to go stay in the shelters, which for the most part were air conditioned and much preferable place to be. They'd be glad to see clients in that circumstance. But they had to have computers, paper, telephones, and Ellen and her cohorts from the Houston area pro bono council and the law firms they represented came to our rescue immediately. I also should give a shout out to Latham Watkins, who gave us a year's pro bono office space, McGuire Woods, who gave us a year's pro bono office space, and finally to the Pillsbury Law Firm, which interestingly enough, if you ever come across this again, has a pro bono program for fire litigation for nonprofits. Yeoman service in getting things put together so construction can start on our building, and like I say, we're hoping to move in February. Needless to say, oh, I forgot to mention that Governor Abbott estimated that Harvey cost $175 billion worth, and it was allegedly put in the number two slot behind Katrina. Harvey's a sort of storm we're going to see more of, where they go up and down the coast and back and forth. They're Category 5 for a while, or Category 4 for a while, and then they drop down, and then they stall and move, and that's where the rain comes from. I'm told that we're going to see more and more of those. Lord, help us if we had St. Dorian come across in a different way. We had Bahamas, in addition to all the serious hardcore flooding that you already saw in North Carolina and other parts.
Thank you, Paul. A couple of takeaways there. Responders themselves are often victims of disasters, and they have to have the mechanisms in place to be able to help themselves before they're able to help others. Listen to how many people in Paul's office lost their housing and had to take care of their families immediately. One of the points of the report issued today is the importance of continuity of operations planning, both for legal services providers and for the courts. That they're not going to be able to help others if they're not able to get themselves up and running quickly after a disaster that may have had a devastating effect on their operations. I'd like to turn now to the legal issues that arise after a disaster. It comes as news to a lot of people that there are many legal issues that arise in connection with a disaster. They're not as obvious to people as the physical consequences of a disaster, but they're very real. And they have a significant impact on lives, particularly the lives of low-income people. Paul, could you describe the range of legal issues that you've seen in natural disasters, particularly arising after Harvey?
All the legal problems that occur for legal service providers occur in a hurricane. As you might imagine, domestic violence increases when people are crowded together in tight spaces, and that's a big issue. Real emergency nature to it when it comes up. Applying for family benefits is something that you have to learn to do quickly, efficiently, and you train as many people as you can so that that spreads itself around. I think I mentioned earlier there were close to a million applications for FEMA help and all of Harvey. That is a lot of paper. And it helps if that paper is filled out correctly. It helps if somebody's monitoring the denial process. Sometimes you can get things to change something, at least successfully did, most legal aid programs do, in a given area that speed things up accordingly.
Well, can I ask you, could you say something a little more about the FEMA application process? I would have thought that the FEMA application process would be designed to be simple, to be self-executed, that you wouldn't need a lawyer to file a FEMA application. What's the reality?
That's what they say about your IRS test. I suppose for some people they are simple, and it's not just that the forms are complicated, it's that folks have different situations, and in order to explain them on paper requires some thought, and frequently some additional thought before you can actually submit it. I think FEMA's done a good job of trimming it up, speeding it up. and they certainly listened to us, and we could show them, you know, that it was affecting large numbers of folks. But on the other hand of that, these are not simple matters. If you're going to expend federal monies, they have to be done carefully and properly, and it's just a big, big part of the job, and everyone has to know about it. It's the sort of thing you can train and teach new lawyers or even paralegals an awful lot to help speed up the process, but there's still issues. The lawyer that has some experience with this and that has to look at it's a pretty sizable organizational issue to get everybody on the same page with that. Now, FEMA, you consider that to be a federal benefit. It's largely focused on housing and getting folks into housing, or at least getting the ball started on that. But it's worth noting that in a hurricane, be it wind, be it flood, be it whatever it may be, the real issue is the low-income affordable housing is frequently hit the hardest. And our folks, our clients, are the first people out. They usually live in areas that are lower. The buildings are usually substandard. Many times they're real substandard. Sometimes they just haven't been built up to code because they're old. So the logic of all of this is that where poor folks live is generally going to be affected worse than other areas. And that's certainly been our experience in Harvey, Hurricane Ike, and Hurricane Rita. Now, it's worth noting, not everything happened in Houston. We had some of our most serious damage and the highest percentage of homes that were destroyed over towards the Beaumont, Port Alfred area, the Golden Triangle on the Louisiana border. So you pick up a lot of rural areas in all this, too. It's just so that we have more resources in Houston because so many people are there and pull together to do it. Emergency shelters, when they first opened up, legal aid programs can have a great impact on behalf of clients simply by being there and being an advocate for doing things in a client-friendly way. Because people get in a hurry, there's a disaster, people are trying to move fast, and sometimes decisions get made that don't work out so well in the practical application, and a legal aid lawyer could be a big help to say, you know, I'm not going to go sue you, but you're going to be sued in a pistol. There's no time to go sue anybody in situations like that, which is worth noting. But the fact is, folks who've been around emergency shelters, and if you do legal aid very long, you're probably going to get that experience, or at least some of them are, can have a real healthy impact on everything simply by being there. Consumer insurance issues, poor people own homes too. In Houston, less than 15% of the population have flood insurance. So, you bend your legal advice to whether or not they have flood insurance or not. And if you have flood insurance in Texas, it's not the easiest claim in the world to make. It's fairly complicated. There's lots of ins and outs to it. There are private lawyers that specialize in that sort of thing. And certainly, Harvey, they lend their expertise freely to all of us. And that was really appreciated. Education. A lot of school districts expect for you to get your kids back in school, and they'll file truancy claims against you if they're not. Interestingly enough, federal law prohibits doing that if they're homeless, which for a lot of our clients, that's exactly the shelter, that sort of thing. But you'd be surprised at how often issues like that would come up. So every sort of legal issue that you can imagine comes up, but it comes up with a real distinct flavor because of the hurricanes.
Thank you, Paul. A few points about relationships there. One, Paul mentioned the importance of relationships with FEMA in trying to resolve the complexity of the application process. FEMA is not the enemy here. The relationship is not going to be productive if it's adversarial. And FEMA has been very responsive to suggestions from legal aid lawyers about how they might be able to improve the process to make it more friendly to people who need their services. Another important relationship with the Red Cross. Paul mentioned having access to shelters and recovery centers. When legal aid lawyers first tried to get access to recovery centers, Red Cross people didn't know really what a legal aid lawyer was. They thought that these were lawyers for pay, fishing for clients, looking to make a buck, that they were soliciting business. How would they know otherwise? And they were trying to protect people and wanted to keep them out. Well, through the relationship building process and explaining what the role of legal aid lawyers is, there's now a strong working relationship with Red Cross, and legal aid lawyers are welcomed to the centers that the Red Cross operates. And finally, the example of home ownership that that Paul cited. This was a particular issue after Katrina. A lot of low-income people own homes that have been passed down through the generations, and they don't have deeds. The transmittals over the course of the generations were not documented in a way that gives them something to take to a FEMA office to be able to make a claim. There are ways to remedy that and retroactively to document the ownership of property. You need a lawyer to do it. George, could you talk about some of the unanticipated legal issues that come up? In legal aid generally, we find that often people who have legal problems don't self-identify their problem as legal. They don't know what remedies are available to them. Could you give some examples of legal help that is available to people that they might not know about, and how legal aid can educate people about that kind of assistance?
Thanks, Jim. I'd like to concur with Paul's observation that it's absolutely essential that legal aid lawyers are in the shelters, in the disaster recovery centers. Recovery starts the minute they survive the storm. And to have a successful recovery, it has to be fast and it has to start immediately. And you have to realize that, yes, Legal Services Corporation and legal aid organizations work with the poor. This was a disaster. There are a whole cohort of newly poor. Florence wiped out about 45% of the small businesses in 31 counties. Those people who were getting paychecks now are without jobs. Those business owners are now without businesses. They are LSC eligible. They are now our clients. They don't know where to turn. They've never been in this situation before. How does that community recover if we're not there to help them and guide them with staff attorneys and pro bono attorneys who can help them get through those speed bumps? Literacy issues with FEMA. You want an advocate when you're filling out a government form like that. You want to put your best foot forward, and lawyers are known to do that. So we help with that process. That has to be part of the process going forward. Landlords don't know what to do. We approach this, we often represent tenants in eviction matters, but in this disaster, everyone's in the same boat. Landlords, many of whom are blue collar, working, they own their home, they're one mortgage a payment away from being a tenant again themselves. They have a mortgage, their house is flooded. Do they stop charging rent? What do? They're gonna get some FEMA money to remediate the mold and the crud in their apartment. What do they do with the personal belongings of the tenant? Should they just throw them out? Where is the tenant? The tenant could be two counties away. Those kinds of questions come up all the time. And we need to be able to tell landlords what their rights, what their obligations are. We need to tell tenants what their rights and obligations are. If we can stabilize them, if they have the knowledge going forward right away, that decreases the psychological first aid that they're going to need, and it's going to improve their options and improve the likelihood that they're going to recover successfully. So it's important that we're there to do that. We train all of our lawyers on what we call trauma-informed advocacy. Our lawyers get psychological first aid, the same first aid training that Red Cross volunteers get. These people are under extreme duress. They don't know what they don't even know. And so lawyers are essential there. For every 10 hours I spend in shelters, disaster recovery centers, giving people information, I'm probably saving between 50 and 70 hours of court time from complications that result if I let things languish. If we can give people information that's going to prevent them from getting involved in litigation down the road, we save dollars. Emergency management, like Will, they get better information, better results. What were the damages? who's been impacted by this? What are the costs involved here? And we can reduce those costs at the other end as we go down the road here. We're not litigating. We're not spending time in court. We can help with recovery. So those are the kinds of issues that, that we need that don't even occur to people right away.
Thank you, George. A critical component of providing legal assistance after a disaster is the private law, pro bono lawyers. Ellen, can you talk about pro bono legal assistance following a disaster and about the value of relationships there? What kind of relationships you and your firm have had with other law firms? How you mobilized across the legal community to provide help after Harvey?
Hi, I'm thrilled to be here discussing what has now become a favorite topic of mine. Personally, maybe not so much. Harvey was really the third storm in 3 years that hit these same communities pretty hard. We had a tax day flood, then we had the Memorial Day flood, and then we had Harvey. And as has been stated before, that was compounding on similar communities, similar neighborhoods. People were just coming back into their houses from the tax day flood during the Memorial Day flood. And so it was very clear this was going to take a lot of resources, legal and otherwise. And we were very fortunate to have had prior relationships with the legal aid organizations through our pro bono programs. So we had been doing work with Lone Star and Houston Volunteer Lawyers and all of the other groups as a regular practice of our pro bono program. So those relationships were already built. So the day Harvey hit, the night Harvey hit, I got immediate word that Lone Star had caught fire. And immediately I knew how to reach some of the folks at Lone Star because we had been previously in contact about other things. And so there were a couple lawyers and I putting our heads together about how we could help Lone Star lawyers help the community. They already needed to be out in the disaster relief centers. And so we needed to be able to, the first thing we wanted to do was to get them computers so that they could get out in the community and help. And so I'm wearing two hats today. I'm the pro bono counsel at Vinson & Elkins, but at the time I was also a board member of the Association of Pro Bono Counsel. So not only was I able to mobilize the Houston community, and V&E has a pretty large presence there, but I had pro bono counsel friends from other states who reached out and said, what can we do? And we were able to get the Supreme Court to issue that Katrina-like rule where out-of-state lawyers can help. And so we had one program going of trying to train and mobilize lawyers from all over the country to take these cases once they became available. At the same time, we were coordinating getting computers, cell phones, printers, scanners for the Lone Star legal aid lawyers who were out in the community helping. Another sort of interesting thing we did, our offices were closed for a couple days. I had several families living in my house. It was kind of a crazy time. One of the first things Lone Star asked us was, could you make copies of all of these Know Your Rights materials that we're going to distribute to the disaster relief centers? And I thought, and I had partners and associates reaching out, what can we do? What can we do? And I said, well, if you're here, I'm running every copy machine on the 26th and 27th floor because our graphics teams were dealing with their own work. So I think we provided 25,000 copies of Know Your Rights tenant things, Know Your Rights landlords, FEMA tips in a million languages. Houston is the most diverse city in the country. So we wanted to make sure we were able to reach everyone. And then pretty close to right away, we set up a system with Houston Volunteer Lawyers where we could send a link out to the Houston bar and say, what shift do you want to come to the George R. Brown Convention Center and stand at the legal aid table and learn how to be a legal aid lawyer from the folks that were there? And so we had a previous system we used during the travel ban where we had shifts of lawyers going to the airport, and we just changed the name of the shift link and we switched it to Harvey. And so we had lawyers signing up for half day and full day where they would just go to the convention centers and stand at the table and be instructed by the legal aid lawyers on what to do. After sort of the initial emergency, we realized what the legal needs were going to be. There was going to be a tremendous amount of landlord-tenant issue, housing issues, FEMA issues. So we started to train as many lawyers as we could on what we anticipated the problem being. So, and not just at Vincent Elkins, but through ABCO, we were able to send out training videos that Legal Aid had produced so that people were at the ready. And I think one of the things that we learned so well is it would have been really great to have an annual training on disaster relief so that when these storms hit and they are coming all the time, the lawyers are already trained. So we already have lawyers that have been trained, but I would love, one of my goals is to make it a part of our regular curriculum at V&E, FEMA training, some landlord-tenant issues, some benefit issues, because we really see that a lot and we are able to help a lot of people. One of the things that I'm proudest of that we have done, as we've heard, these disasters do last a long time. The legal needs change over time. What people need might change, but victims of these disasters are still victims a year and 2 years later. And so we created with a legal services organization, clinics, virtual clinics we could do for Harvey victims. And so I think we actually launched it 1 year following the storm. So people were calling in with issues, you know, I paid to have this remediated and nobody came. I was supposed to get this benefit and I didn't get it. I got an incorrect benefit. I'm getting incorrect advice from the insurance company. And so the issues are different a year and 2 years later, but it is important that we now sort of know what they're going to be, that we keep lawyers trained at the ready. And that is where the relationships come about, because we're not experts in this. If there were, you know, some sort of energy merger, we could train all of you lawyers. But we rely on the legal aid lawyers to train our lawyers. And so those relationships are so important to have all the time, not just in an emergency. When legal aid caught fire and I wanted to help, if I didn't know Paul's staff, who to call, how to reach them, if I didn't know that before the storm, I certainly wasn't going to be able to find them during the storm. And so it's really important. We all have these wonderful groups that we can rely on. The Association of Pro Bono Counsel is a bunch of people like me. There are several of us in the room. We can get the word quickly out to the private bar. We are hopeful that more states will issue that Katrina rule. We struggled. We had all these lawyers after Harvey that were all trained. And when Maria hit, we had all these lawyers that wanted to help in Florida, and we could not. So it's something to think about. That is a real issue. We had FEMA very well-trained lawyers that couldn't help in Florida. They could help. There are other states that would let us. So I think working together often and staying in touch with each other often and finding out what those needs are is the way we can really contribute the most after the disaster.
Thank you, Ellen. I'd like to wrap up by asking the three panelists who were members of the task force to pick your favorite recommendation. You get one, you got to do it quickly. Explain what your favorite recommendation is and why. I'll start with you, Paul.
Well, picking up on Ellen's comment, I put down train. Recommendation A5, providing training on how to identify disaster-related civil legal issues. And recommendation B4, training often. If I had a takeaway from the disaster report, it would be that, and we're going to talk.
Ellen?
Well, it was very difficult. It's like picking a favorite child, I think. But deploying pro bono attorneys is an incredible resource, and there are so many lawyers. There are so many lawyers. And if we could get a percentage of them deployed. So I have found that there are very few, I call them no bonos in the world, a very few lawyers that don't want to help at all with anything ever. Most people want to help. They are nervous. They don't know how to help. They don't know exactly what they could do. You know, I'm a merger, an M&A lawyer. What could I do? And so my job as pro bono counsel is to give them the training and the confidence that they can help, because I think the desire to help is there. So I picked recommendation A7 and how to deploy those volunteers.
And Will, what's your favorite?
My favorite is building relationships on sunny sky
yep.
days. That's super critical. because the cycle of emergency management, from mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery, they're all interdependent. And so it's very critical to make these relationships in sunny sky situations, so that when the situation comes up, like I had during Dorian, where we had a situation where people were not able, having difficulty to getting out of a situation. The relationships that we built, not only during the storm, but also just built on that relationship in a sunny sky, I was able to pick up the phone, get resources, find stakeholders and allies to get those people out. So that's really critical for me, is those relationships, because the other thing that came out loud and clear in this session today is that not only does the disaster create new legal issues, but people have pre-existing legal issues before the disaster hits. And so whether it's, I try to take the approach of all hazards, not just hurricanes. I think wildfires and all these other crazy scenarios, cyber, whatever. But, having those relationships helps those individuals not only deal with the new legal issues that comes up because of the storm, but the pre-existing legal issues that they may have as far as family law, landlord-tenant, healthcare issues, whatever, income inequality, whatever the issue is, those relationships are just very critical to having successful outcomes for disaster survivors.
One of the things that we came across that you guys will see is that people don't have their documents in a storm. So that, people don't have proof. I mean, even if they have clear title, they don't have anything anymore. So one of the things that we're trying to do in our regular pro bono program is to talk to people like I used to do. I was a domestic violence lawyer. I used to talk to people at safety planning with every client, every person, every time I met them. Now we're talking to them about disaster preparedness. Do you have copies of all your kids' birth certificates and your title in a place that's safe? Because what would happen was, it's not sometimes they weren't entitled to benefits, but they couldn't prove them up. So I would advise in sunny skies to be advising all legal aid clients and all pro bono clients to make sure that they're as ready as they can be. That's my advice from these storms.
Thank you. We have a lot of experience and wisdom here. Thank you all for sharing it. Would you please join me in thanking our panelists? One of the nation's leading experts in emergency management and homeland security. He's had a remarkable career. His career includes service on the front lines of emergencies and disasters, as well as policy development and implementation at the federal, state, and local levels. He's a 20-year veteran of the New York City Fire Department. He started as a firefighter and retired as a captain. He's led response and recovery efforts at several major events, including 9/11, Hurricanes Sandy, Harvey, and Maria, the Haiti earthquake, as well as on a number of other national level events. On the policy side, Mr. Byrne has spearheaded the effort of the creation of the New York City Office of Emergency Management, as well as the newly formed Office of Homeland Security in the White House after 9/11. While he was at the White House, Mr. Byrne held the position of Senior Director for Preparedness, Response, and Recovery, and played a significant role in developing and implementing Homeland Security Presidential Directive 5 and the grant programs that provide critical support to the nation's first responders. He's held leadership roles in the private and nonprofit sectors, including senior level positions with the American Red Cross, Microsoft, and ICF. He currently serves as a specialist executive with Deloitte, where he continues his lifelong commitment to ensuring that the nation is better equipped to prepare for, respond to, and recover from the consequences of disaster events. Would you please welcome Michael Byrne?
Thank you, Jim. And thanks to the panel. Everything you brought up is just near and dear to my heart in terms of living through it and every one of the disasters that were just mentioned. I will tell you, there is nothing more demoralizing to the teams that go out, like when I lead the FEMA teams in the field, to run into these issues and not be able to help. To have a piece of paper to stop assistance is probably one of the It's something that I had the biggest challenges of, just keeping with the morale of my team focused so that they'd be able to get beyond it. So thank you. I'll just start by saying thank you all for what you do and for the report that you got out. I really hope that we're able to learn a lot from it. I do want to take a few minutes I have to talk about preparedness. And I think it's become clear from the legal side a lot of the things that are certainly impossible. But every one of us gets the preparedness message at a different point in time in our life. I believe sometimes something has to happen that turns your mind to think about, wow, this is real. And certainly people in the South, you know it better than most. Will, as you know. But I want to share my personal story when preparedness struck a chord for me. It actually goes back, way back to the beginning of my career, 1979. I was a brand new firefighter in New York City. And unfortunately, I went to what was ended up being one of many fatal fires. And I was introduced to the conditions under which that happens, and unfortunately, this young man passed away as a result of the fire that he had in his small studio apartment, actually. And it was a fairly new building, and that puzzled me. And I thought, well, geez, why did it's a new building? Why didn't they have a smoke detector? You know, they're very popular even then. And then when I mentioned that to one of my colleagues, one of the more senior firefighters, and he said, well, he did have a smoke detector. And he takes me over, and it's the smoke cleared in the room, and we can start to see the walls and everything. And he showed me a blob of plastic that was on the wall that had melted to the wall. And geez, why didn't that go off? And then he showed me a shelf next to the smoke detector, and what was sitting on the shelf? But the battery. I will never forget that. And I, granted, it's not a FEMA form, but it is certainly something that gave me the message that you gotta be prepared, and you gotta use your preparedness and rely on your preparedness. Simple messages, you know, to people, I think are the real key. You know, we in the fire service, we came up with stop, drop, and roll. How many people have heard of that, right? You know, I mean, everybody knows that one. And the same thing now with, when it comes to disaster preparedness, it's have a kit, and who better to help people figure out what papers need to be in that kit than you all, okay? Have a plan, and share your plan. You know, a plan kept to itself is, you know, not letting your kids know where who they're supposed to call and when they're supposed to call when something happens and the family's not together is not a good plan, but have a plan. And then lastly, stay informed. Because it, you know, like the amount of information, as we all know, that's out there is truly incredible. And there's lots of different avenues where you can find out that information. Have a kit, have a plan, and what was the third one?
Okay,
information. Thank you. The good news is, I wanted to finally share with you, is that things are getting better. FEMA does an analysis every year, a survey on preparedness, and the numbers are going up. Now, that may be a result of the increasing number of and severity of the incidents that we're having. That certainly may be the case. But whatever it is, we're grateful for the improvements. But let's, you know, all continue that message of being prepared. And I'll share a happier story, and what led me to believe that things are getting better, and especially in the FEMA world, because unfortunately FEMA's systems are set up to verify then trust, not trust but verify, okay? And you know, it's and because we're using tax dollars and we have to be good stewards, so we have to do that. So I'll share a story from Sandy. I was the federal coordinating officer. I was out in the field. I went to a disaster recovery center. And I walked in, and it was a tent in the Far Rockaways part of New York. And as you can tell with my accent, that I was very comfortable there. And I saw this lady sitting at a desk, and a FEMA person behind the thing was asking her, do you have this form? Do you have this piece of documentation? this went on for about 5 or 10 minutes, ended up asking about 12 pieces of paper. The final lady got so fed up that she stood up and she says, "What else you got? What else you need?" And she was like, "Bring it on. I got it all right here." So I do think your message, the message that you are the evangelist for, and I do mean that word, you are the evangelist for this message, is being heard. And I commend you and I ask you, please keep up all the good work that you're doing. Thank you.
A few minutes ago now, is Rob here right now?
He's here, John.
Is Rob Alanek here?
I'm back.
He was here for a few minutes. I saw him come in, and I wanted to make sure we acknowledged his work. I do want to point out that we have a number of LSC board members here. I see Abby Kuzma from Indiana in the back, and Gloria Valencia Weber from New Mexico. I see John Malcolm from the District of Columbia. Of course, Father Baxter wouldn't let me introduce him. Did I miss any of our board members? But I want to tell you that that shows their own commitment, because they've come from quite some distance to be here. We also have members of our Leaders Council and Emerging Inter Council here, and I want to thank them for their ongoing support and interest in LSC and all of the things that it's trying to do across the country. And it's my privilege now to welcome one of the great friends of LSC, Judge Jonathan Lipman. You know, his career spans more than 4 decades. How did that happen?
I don't know.
Judge Lipman, he served at all levels of the New York State court system. Staff attorney, administrator, and judge. The longest tenured chief administrative judge in the state history of New York before going on to be its chief judge of the New York Court of Appeals for 7 years. He's now a counsel at Latham Watkins. He's a member of the firm's litigation department. He provides strategic counsel to clients, a leader in the firm's pro bono practice. But most important to us, he's been a lifelong champion of equal access to justice. His initiatives in New York are legendary, supporting pro bono efforts, establishing the pro bono Scholars Poverty Justice Solutions program to help address the crisis in civil legal services. And New York became the first state in the country, you probably knew this if you were in law school, to require 50 hours of law-related pro bono work prior to admission. He strengthened the state's indigent criminal defense system, led efforts to reform the juvenile justice bail, pretrial justice systems, and my gosh, he got the state of New York to support legal services. So in addition to his service as co-chair on this remarkable task force, a lifelong supporter of LSC, he is frequently, we bring him out to moderate congressional briefings and forums across the country, and we really almost, he's one of our moderators in chief when Jim's not available. And so here he is in person. We're so proud to have him be a part of the team.
I bring John with me wherever I go. And he never says no. So we're nearing the end of today. And I want to thank John for his tremendous leadership. The more than 60 members of the task force and my two co-chairs, Martha Minow and Father Pius, for working so diligently for more than a year on this remarkable project. I also want to express my gratitude. And Rob, you'll call out, you missed your call out, but I'm giving it to you again. Rob Malionik, who headed the Latham staff, who have just been spectacular, and their tireless work has been instrumental in producing this report. So Rob, thank you, we're very proud of you, and the Latham team, we're very proud of all of you. I also want to express our gratitude to Lynn Jennings and the LSC staff, the really terrific LSC staff, for their wonderful work in support of the task force. There are many findings and recommendations. We expect you to read each and every one of them. But in large part, like so many things in life, it's all about the relationships. Building partnerships to prepare for disasters and to enable the legal community to be in a better position to serve and assist low-income disaster survivors. To do that, we must foster communication, cooperation, and coordination among the emergency management community, legal aid providers, the private bar, the judiciary, community-based organizations, and the business community. The very lives of human beings are at stake. We must all, in our respective roles, be better prepared. This isn't about expecting the unexpected. Given the more than 530 presidential disaster and emergency declarations that have been issued since 2014, this is expecting the expected and being ready for it. We have produced a detailed, concrete guide to help legal service providers and the courts to be primed and ready to ensure that our justice system functions as it must in times of disaster. Similarly, we have produced detailed checklists to help low-income individuals, families, and communities prepare for, respond to, and recover from the legal challenges of a disaster. And remember, it's the most vulnerable in our society who are most impacted by these natural disasters. Our hope and recommendation is that legal aid providers will use these checklists and other materials to help individuals and families in the community to be ready to meet their legal needs both pre and post-disaster. The release of this report is not nearly the end of our efforts. As John Levy said, LSC will establish a high-level working group to assist in implementing these recommendations and continue to educate the emergency management community about the importance of integrating legal service providers in their work. We need a seat at the table. This is what this is all about. Communication back and forth. All of us being there before and after. This is by no means, a one and done endeavor for us. We are really just beginning. Look at what happens each and every day in this country. LSC, with the help of the working group, will also work to establish a one-stop online resource for disaster training materials and expertise, open to pro bono lawyers and other volunteers, legal aid lawyers, and disaster survivors. There is so much to do, so much ahead of us, to better prepare and respond to the daunting challenge and cycle of post-disaster civil legal issues. And it is our fervent hope that our work here will provide an invaluable guide before and after disaster strike to those who will undertake this critically important work. We are so delighted to be able to present this report to you today. And to really finish today's event on a high note, our dear friend Martha Minow, who is, as always, teaching, what would you expect, is now going to say a few words by video.
This week, people around the world are recovering from natural disasters that have destroyed their homes, their communities, and their hopes. The response to natural disasters has to improve and is improving all over the world. But one element in the United States that has not been integrated in disaster preparedness and disaster relief, as well as it should, is the legal element. And by that I mean access to law. I am very proud of the work of the Disaster Relief Task Force because the enormous and thoughtful efforts by people in the disaster relief community and people in the legal community have demonstrated the productive possibilities in integrating the legal aspects. Of course, right after a disaster, people are searching for food and safety. And often law is an important part of that. As time passes, law becomes even more central and is a tool as people try to rebuild their lives. Being able to think about this in advance and build the capacity inside of legal institutions, courts, legal services organizations, as well as across all of the disaster relief organizations. These are the goals and these are the possibilities with many great models already underway in this country. I give my deepest thanks to everyone who participated in this effort and look forward to a day in which disaster preparedness, disaster relief, integrate law in the ways that this report outlines.
Thank you all for coming. And thank you again to our staff at LSC, to the Latham firm, and to all of you who made this this report possible. Look for our continuing rollout events across the country. I'm sure you'll want to attend them when we come to your local community. But more importantly, I hope that you will help us educate both the legal community and the preparedness community, the response team, the emergency management team, about the importance of integrating civil legal aid into their preparedness. Thank you.